Bless the Lord who forgives all our sins. Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought. Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Lord be with you. Let us pray. Almighty Father, whose dear Son, on the night before he suffered, instituted the sacrament of his body and blood, mercifully grant that we may receive it thankfully in remembrance of Jesus Christ our Lord, who in these holy mysteries gives us a pledge of eternal life, and who now lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen.
Reading from the book of Exodus. The Lord said to Moses and Aaron in the land of Egypt, "This month shall mark for you the beginning of months. It shall be the first month of the year for you. Tell the whole congregation of Israel that on the 10th of this month they are to take a lamb for each family, a lamb for each household. If a household is too small for a whole lamb, it shall join its closest neighbor in obtaining one. The lamb shall be divided in proportion to the number of people who eat of it. This is how you shall eat it: your loins girded, your sandals on your feet, and your staff in your hand, and you shall eat it hurriedly. It is the Passover of the Lord. For I will pass through the land of Egypt that night, and I will strike down every firstborn in the land of Egypt, both human beings and animals. On all the gods of Egypt I will execute judgments. I am the Lord. The blood shall be a sign for you on the houses where you live. When I see the blood, I will pass over you, and no plague shall destroy you when I strike the land of Egypt. This day shall be a remembrance for you. You shall celebrate it as a festival to the Lord. Throughout your generations, you shall observe it as a perpetual ordinance." Word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Okay, we will all read the psalm together. I love the Lord because he has the heard voice of my supplication, because he has inclined his ear to me whenever I called upon him. How I shall repay the Lord for all the good things he has done for me. I will lift up the cup of salvation and call upon the name of the Lord. I will fulfill my own vows to the Lord in the presence of all his people. Precious is the sight of the Lord, is the death of his servants. O Lord, I am your servant. I am your servant and the child of your handmaid. You have freed me from my bonds. will offer you the sacrifice of thanksgiving and call upon the name of the Lord. I will fulfill my vows to the Lord in the presence of all his people. In the courts of the Lord's house, in the midst of you, O Jerusalem. Hallelujah. A reading from the letter of Paul to the Corinthians. For I received from the Lord what I also handed on to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took a loaf of bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body that is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, he took the cup also after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." Word of the Lord.
The Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to John.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Before the festival of the Passover, Jesus knew that his hour had come to depart from this world and go to the Father. Having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. The devil had already put it into the heart of Judas, son of Simon Iscariot, to betray him. And during supper, Jesus, knowing that the Father had given all things into his hands, and that he had come from God and was going to God, got up from the table, took off his outer robe, and tied a towel around himself. Then he poured water into a basin and began to wash the disciples' feet and to wipe them with the towel that was tied around him. He came to Simon Peter, who said to him, "Lord, are you going to wash my feet?" Jesus answered, "You do not know what I am doing, but later you will understand." Peter said to him, "You will never wash my feet." Jesus answered, "Unless I wash you, you have no share with me." Simon Peter said to him, "Lord, not only my feet, but also my hands and my head." Jesus said to him, "One who has bathed does not need to wash except for the feet, but is entirely clean. And you are clean, though not all of you." For he knew who was to betray him, And for this reason he said, "Not all of you are clean." After he had washed their feet, had put on his robe, and had returned to the table, he said to them, "Do you know what I have done for you? You call me teacher and Lord, and you are right, for that is what I am. So if I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also ought to wash one another's feet. For I have set you an example, that you also should do as I have done for you. Very truly I tell you, servants are not greater than their master, nor are messengers greater than the one who sent them. If you know these things, you are blessed if you do them. Now the Son of Man has been glorified, and God has been glorified in him. If God has been glorified in him, God will also glorify him in himself and will glorify him at once. Little children, I am with you only a little longer. You will look for me, and as I said to the others, so now I say to you, where I am going, you cannot come. I give you a new commandment, that you love one another, just as I have loved you. You also should love one another. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
To you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Our collect today, the prayer for Maundy Thursday, has a key word in it that I think if you're listening, you would have heard repeated through the other readings that we've had. And we'll hear again later as we celebrate the Eucharist. That word is remembrance. We begin our readings with an ancient text telling an ancient story. It's the tail end, really. Well, it's not even quite the end, but it's toward the end of that salvation story of God's people, where they had been enslaved in Egypt. And we get this showdown between God, the God of the Hebrews, and Pharaoh, and the Egyptian gods. And through the plagues and his messenger Moses, God wears them down until finally Pharaoh says, "Let my people go." But we're not quite there yet. This is just before the 10th plague. When God, through the mouthpiece of Moses, tells the people what is going to happen, he instructs them to always remember. From the very first time that they engage in this ritual meal, where they're eating unleavened bread, there's no time for the bread to rise. You've got to bake it flat. You've got to eat with your shoes on and your bag ready to go. And you need to eat quickly. There is no time. It's time to go. From the very beginning, the first time, God says, "Do it this way, and every year thereafter, do it this way again. Remember. Remember where you came from, that you were freed from the yoke of oppression, that you came out of slavery and became a new people. Remember." And so we find ourselves thousands of years later, retelling the same story, remembering the salvation, literally the saving and the creation of a people whose experience of God would shine God's light and love to the rest of the world. This is their foundation. And by remembering, they know who they are and whose they are and how to continue to live in that way. Our second reading is from the letter of Paul to the church at Corinth. This letter of Paul's is probably older than the Gospels. It's one of the earliest writings of the New Testament. And in it, Paul says, I've handed on to you what was given to me. We've already got this passing on of things remembered. And he says, this is what was given to me, that on the night he was betrayed, the night he was about to suffer, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. He blessed it, and he broke it, and he gave it. And in that first meal that was experienced this way, the ritual and the remembrance began. For he said, take, eat, do this in remembrance of me, and continue to do this until I come back. This, too, is a meal that is time-sensitive, and an outward-looking nourishment for the body. It is a preparation for what is to come, both for the disciples there with Jesus and for us as we partake of it ritually in the Eucharist. It is a meal that we receive in a safe place where we are loved, where we are in an eye of calm, no matter what storms might be raging in the world. It is an intimate meal taken with friends, people who are like family, people that have to be told to be nice to each other in the kitchen. Literally, I did that today. People who rib each other. People who are there in a heartbeat the minute any other one of you needs something. People who've walked alongside one another for years or months. Family, friends. And this meal that we partake of together in this place is what prepares us to follow Jesus' commandment as we get another image of the same meal from the Gospel of John, where he says, you want people to know whose you are. You want people to know you are mine. Then love each other. Love one another as he has loved us. This evening is incredibly special, not just in the church year, but in our experience of it tonight. This is the first agape meal that I have had the thrill and delight of partaking of here at St. Luke's. This is the first time in a few years that all of you have gotten to renew your experience of this tradition that I know has been done here for a long time. We keep the meal simple on purpose because there's so much to focus on and prepare for with the marathon of Holy Week about to begin. But we sit around a table close together and we trade banter, we trade compliments on the food, we ask for the salt and the bread to be passed, and we remember whose we are. And where we are going when the meal is over. In Jesus' meal with his friends, there is another ritual which is enacted particularly on this night. And it's a way of remembering that helps us to experience in our bodies what happened in that story. Just as we eat at a table, just as we have bread and the fruit of the vine, and tangibly remember the story, so tonight we will also use basins of water and towels to remember what Jesus told us to do in the way that we could show the world whose we are and that we love one another. We will wash one another's feet. It's another action that requires a sort of intimacy, a trust between one another, to engage in something that requires vulnerability, to allow someone else to wash your feet. Notice I didn't say it requires that to wash someone else's. I think that for a lot of us, the resonant voice in this gospel, and I'll just say I'm speaking for myself and maybe some of you, is Peter saying, oh no, you're not washing my feet. Mm-mm. Nope. Yet the thing is, put this into the context of this time period, this culture, this place. Peter needed his feet washed. You wear sandals out on a dirt road, you need your feet washed. It's okay for a servant to do it. That's what their job is. But to have someone you respect and esteem kneel before you and wash the road grime off your feet, that's hard. And in a culture today which prizes to a fault, seriously, a fault, which prizes independence and self-reliance, it's really, really hard not to get down and wash someone else's feet, but to sit in the chair and let water be poured over your own. We are really good at St. Luke's, at serving others. I've seen it time and time again. I saw it before I came here, what drew me here, how deeply committed you folks are to making sure that people are fed, that people are clothed, that people are accepted here just as they are, as God made them and as God loves them. I wonder tonight, can we be vulnerable enough to listen to the Savior's words when he says, you need to have your feet washed. You cannot have a share in me unless you let me wash your feet. See, if we don't let other people wash our feet, whether that's literally in a ritual or metaphorically by letting other people see our needs, how do we let them take up the service to which Christ calls all of us? If we are so invested in projecting our facade of self-reliance that we can never let anyone else serve us, we are denying others the opportunity to serve where God is calling them to. It takes vulnerability and trust to sit in the chair and say, okay, I need someone to wash my feet. Is not an easy thing to do. This is what God asks of us, not just tonight in this service, but ongoing in our lives. When he says, love one another as I have loved you, remember, remember, remember. You are called to form a community that can expand because it's healthy, because it models trust, it models give and take, it models offering and receiving. We have two people named aside from Jesus in the gospel story tonight. Peter. Lovable Peter. No, you can't wash my feet. Okay, fine, wash everything. And then we have Judas. He's the other named disciple. Both of them got their feet washed by Jesus that night. Both of them were seen by the eyes of Jesus in their hearts for who they are and who they were before him in that moment. Both of them took the bread that he broke and ate it. And both of them went out and betrayed him after that night. Judas for 30 pieces of silver and the collaboration with the power that would crucify Jesus in a matter of hours. And Peter, who was standing by wanting to know what was happening, but so afraid of being hauled up next to Jesus and being put on the cross with him, that even to someone of no status, a serving girl, he would say, "No, I don't know him. I don't know Jesus." "Oh, weren't you one of his followers?" she asks. "Oh, no. No, I don't know him." Three times. We know from the scriptures and tradition of the early church that Judas' life would sort of freeze and be defined by that betrayal. He will die shortly after, according to scriptures, by his own hand, perhaps eaten up with guilt, just so overcome that he could no longer live with what he had done. And Peter would go on to be visited to receive the presence of the risen Christ. And he would hear Jesus say to him, "Peter, do you love me?" And he would get a chance to say yes this time, with no hesitation and with no, "Yes, yes, you know that I love you." And he would be given a commission to go and feed my flock, Jesus told him, to become a leader in the family of God that was just beginning. In these two stories that are side by side the same tonight, I think we can see choices that are in front of us. We don't see ourselves as Judas. Some of us, I don't know whether we see ourselves like Peter, but we all of us come to the table to eat the bread that Jesus blesses and breaks and gives in a human condition. We all come to the table flawed, maybe not 100% committed at that moment, or we may be all in, but we come human. And Jesus receives us as we are, blesses us and serves us and feeds us and embraces us in that moment. And when we go out from this place tonight in silence, with the heaviness of these stories that we remember weighing on us, we can choose how we're going to be in the world, what kind of witness we might be willing to give. There are multiple ways of denying Jesus. It doesn't have to be a dramatic, "No, I never knew him," or a dramatic selling him out to the powers that be. But my hope, my confidence for this church especially, knowing you, knowing your hearts, is that when you go out into this community, it won't be denial, but it will be deep, embodied remembrance that Christ loved you and gave himself for you. You'll know whose you are because you've remembered. And you'll go out in love to wash feet, to feed, to embrace, to love, and to acknowledge your own needs in turn, so that the world will truly know whose disciples we are. Fellow servants of Christ, on the night before his death, Jesus set an example for his disciples by washing their feet, an act of humble service. He taught that strength and growth in the life of the kingdom of God come not by power, authority, or even by miracle, but by such lowly service. Therefore, I invite you, who share in the royal priesthood of Christ, to come forward, that we may recall whose servants we are by following the example of our Master. Come remembering his admonition that what will be done for us is also to be done by us to others. For a servant is not greater than his master, nor is one who is sent greater than the one who sent him. If you know these things, blessed are you if you do them. Those who wish to participate to come forward.
Thank you. Lord Jesus, in washing the feet of your disciples, you gave us an example of true servanthood and love. Hear our prayers for the church and the world as we seek to be more like you. Hear our prayers, Lord, for your church. Help us to proclaim the gospel in all that we say and do, that your message of love may be heard by everyone we meet.
Lord Jesus, help us to be servants of all.
Hear our prayers, Lord, for the nations and all who hold power. Help them to love justice, mercy, truthfulness, and peace.
Lord Jesus, help us to be servants of all.
Hear our prayers, Lord, for our global family. Help us to share your delight in the diversity of our languages, cultures, abilities, and appearances.
Lord Jesus, help us to be servants of all.
Hear our prayers, Lord, for our own families and communities. Help us to embody kindness, patience, and compassion in all of our relationships.
Lord Jesus, help us to be servants of all.
Hear our prayers, Lord, for all who are sick. Help us be agents of comfort and healing.
Lord Jesus, help us to serve
us all. Hear our prayers, Lord, for all whose lives and homes are torn by war. Help us give what we can for their relief while striving for peace and wholeness throughout the world.
Lord Jesus, help us to serve us all.
Hear our prayers, Lord, for all who have died. Help us remember them with thankfulness and entrust them always to your care.
Lord Jesus, help us, your servants of all.
Let us pray for our own needs and those of others, silently or aloud.
Thank you.
The Lord be with you.
Also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth, through Jesus Christ our Lord. For our sins he was lifted high upon the cross, that he might draw the whole world to himself. And by his suffering and death, he became the source of eternal salvation for all who put their trust in him. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Gracious Father, in your infinite love you made us for yourself, and when we had fallen into sin and become subject to evil and death, you in your mercy sent Jesus Christ, your only and eternal Son, to share our human nature, to live and die as one of us, to reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. He stretched out his arms upon the cross and offered himself in obedience to your will, a perfect sacrifice for the whole world. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ has risen. Christ will come again. We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension, we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and unending life in him. Sanctify us also, that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace. And at the last day, bring us with all your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ, by him, and with him, and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power and the glory, forever and ever.
Oh,
the gifts of God for the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. Let us pray. Eternal God, Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and you have fed us with spiritual food in the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace, and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart. Through Christ our Lord. While the altar is lit.
Thank you.
us read together Psalm 22. My God, my God, why have you forsaken me? And are so far from my cry.